I'm particularly happy that you feel well enough to come with all the crazy sickness going on. I believe the Lord will get that fixed for Sunday. Amen. Deuteronomy 28 and 1 through 3 is our theme text for this teaching. It shall come to pass if, everybody say if, thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God to observe all, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that the Lord God will set thee high above all nations of the earth. This was a particular promise to Israel. And all these blessings shall come on thee, overtake thee, and if thou hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, then blessed shalt thou be in the city, and blessed shalt thou be in the field. In other words, you'll be blessed where you live, and you'll be blessed where you work. And so we're talking about being blessed in my field, and what I'm sort of massaging this series toward is the idea of being blessed in my field. What I mean by that is being blessed in my workplace. Now, I want to expand that in your understanding to recognize that what I mean in this teaching is being blessed in whatever your workplace is at this particular time in your life. Even if that workplace is home, being a homemaker, raising kids, whatever, we want to be blessed in what we're doing. Amen. And there was an incredible of anointing that came in here last Wednesday night. And it was a beautiful presence. We talked about why, even though this was written to Israel, that there's an application to us. There's a reason that we're told that spiritual warfare is a battle of the mind. We talked about that because of long times of stress and elongated battles we go through, and sometimes we forget, but we have been given a promise that God is not mocked, and we are told, don't be deceived. God is not mocked. We will reap if we faint not. Our goal is to keep from fainting, but sometimes we do faint, people, so we need some Holy Ghost smelling salts, hallelujah, to come, and the Spirit of the Lord is going to revive some people that have fallen by the wayside. We talked about a little bit of the history, and we talked about an incredible tongues and interpretation that happened New Year's Eve that I am focused on for this early part of the new year. Feel instructed of the Lord to do so, and it is a promise that belongs to NAC. And we're told not to cast away our confidence, because if we don't do that, we might receive the promise. The only thing that's going to cause us to lose the promise is if we lose confidence in the Word of God. So I've been working on building faith. Sunday morning came along, preached another message about why sit here. It was connected to this. So I come into part two tonight. And I want us to, I want you to lay your Bible down for a moment. I want you to lift your voice and pray and ask the Lord to anoint what we're doing as we go into part two. In Jesus' name, Father, we come into this house tonight. Thank you for your presence. And I'm asking you, Lord, to bless this Bible study teaching tonight in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Everybody said amen. God bless you. You may be seated in the name of the Lord. We talked a little bit about last week that Adam was given a beautiful garden, but he was given to dress and keep it. Even in his most perfected state, he was designed for work. Begrudgingly. Amen. But it certainly wouldn't have been as hard a work as what we have to do now. But that is because he valued someone else's voice over the voice of God's. And that's what we were talking about at the end of last week. I want to promise you something. If you decide to value anyone's voice higher than the voice of the Word of God, you will pay for it. I don't mean it as a punishment sense. I mean it in the sense that you posture yourself in a way that makes things harder. When the Lord promised to bless Israel and bless them in the field, he was not removing the curse. But he would say, what he's saying is, I'll push it back some so that you can function and thrive in it. So let's go back to Deuteronomy 28, only this time, tonight, let's go all the way down to verse 9, and let's start reading there. And the Lord shall establish thee an holy people, everybody say holy, unto himself, that means separated, as he has sworn unto thee, if thou shalt keep the commandments of the Lord thy God and walk in his ways, and all the people of the earth shall see that you are called by my name, by the name of the Lord, excuse me, and they shall be afraid of thee. And we were talking about how that actually happened to Israel at one time, even though they were unaware of it. They remember the time David said, we are grasshoppers in their sight. Come to find out, the enemy was shaken by the enemy later told him, when we heard how your God delivered you, when we heard what your God did that brought you out of Egypt, they were shaken in their boots. Let me tell you something. The spiritual world, for sure, and those that are familiar with the spirit world have a much stronger respect for the church than sometimes the people that even go to it. Which is sad, but it is what it is. And just as they were afraid of Israel when they heard of how God delivered them, but Israel was saying, yeah, but we're not. Forget what you see. Ask God to anoint your eyes with eye salve so that we could start to see things how they really are rather than through the voice of the enemy that's constantly trying to downplay. Verse 11, and the Lord shall make thee plenteous in goods, in fruit of the body, in fruit of thy cattle, in the fruit of thy ground, in the land which the Lord sware unto your fathers to give thee. And the Lord shall open unto thee his good treasure. Remember, I was preaching about the fact that the world says you have to fight for your piece of the pie. But the word seems to indicate the Lord is the baker. He can make as many pies as is needed to meet any need. The Lord said, I'll open up to you my good treasure. The heavens to give rain upon the land in a season and to bless all the work of thine hand, and thou shalt lend. And by the way, can I throw this in? Notice when God said, I'll open up these windows and I'll bless you, he was not referring to any sort of a welfare program. I know that disappoints some. But when God said, when I open up the windows of heaven for you, it means that your work will become blessed. Now, if you don't work, you're not going to be blessed. Y'all fighting with me on this, but let me see if I can keep proving my point. He said, the rain will come to the land this season. I'll bless the work of the hand. Thou shalt lend unto many nations, and thou shalt not borrow. And the Lord shall make thee the head and not the tail. And thou shalt be above only, and thou shalt not be beneath. And if, everybody say if. Look at your neighbor and say, this is conditional. If thou hearken unto the commandments of the Lord thy God, which I command thee this day to observe to do them. I want to remind you that if we're going to walk in this kind of blessing, we have to do it God's way. Not the way of our logic. Not the way of what makes sense to us. You know what this really boils down to, folks? This really boils down to one thing, and that is this. How seriously do you as an individual take the Word of God? That's what it simply boils down to. Matter of fact, a lot of things boil down to that. The truth is, even in the church, many don't take it very serious at all. Even people that come to church sometimes, they'll listen to it and unfortunately, it's never engrafted. Sometimes it goes in one ear and out the other. And sometimes I'm convinced it doesn't even go in one ear. Our minds are floating somewhere else. And that's why, by the way, I might add this. You might want to be careful when you're picking out the kind of friends that you're going to hang around with. If you pick out friends that treat the word as trivial, that's going to rub off on you. And you're going to start treating the word more trivial. That's why the Bible says, don't compare yourselves among yourselves. It's not wise. Because if you in your mind think, well, I'm doing better than she is, or I'm doing better than he is, yeah, but neither one of you may be doing very well. Hello? Verse 14. Thou shalt not go aside from any of the words which I command you this day, to the right hand or the left, to go after other gods to serve them. We got to work to find this. The answer is not in the extreme left or the extreme right. It's found in balance. It shall come to pass that if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, and then he starts retroing the whole thing. He said, all these commandments and statutes, all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee. Cursed shall be in the city, cursed shall be in the field, and the basket in thy store. Verse 18, cursed the fruit of the body, the fruit of the increase and the kind. The next few verses going down through verse 20 is he just basically stair steps down everything that the earlier part of the chapter stair stepped up. And so every one of these areas become ultimately a choice. And that's why that it requires us to have faith in the Word of God, because without faith, we cannot please Him. And without faith, we cannot trust Him. And if we don't trust Him, then the Word is never able to be engrafted in us. I am starting out this year with this prophecy in mind because I feel like we need this fresh point of faith, something that we can all look to and say, yes, I see it, I get that. Much like when we pray over a prayer cloth and give some of it, there's no power in the cloth. It's just a point of faith. It's something to build faith, something to visible to look on, or something to hear. And when we read the prophecy that is unfolding, we need to recognize this is what God is saying to us at this time. And I need to hear it. I need to get it into my spirit. I need to know what it is. Because I believe we're come to a time of prophecy, and we have to posture ourselves properly for the increase. I believe God wants to bless us in our field of labor and in our workplace and the things that we put our hands to do. As a matter of fact, Jesus said it this way, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and He hath anointed me too. ... For the rest of the verse, he starts mentioning a number of things that he is anointed to do. Now, I've preached on this before to point this out. The anointing does not come upon a human being for the purpose of just becoming a couch potato. If the Lord anoints you, it's because he has anointed you to do stuff. I'm not just doing this, I'm anointed to do this. I'm gifted to do this. I'm getting help from God to do this. I believe God intends to, or I think maybe the truth is, He already has anointed us to do something, because you know what the book says about us? Every joint should be supplying. Therefore, the Lord will anoint every part of His body. And that's why every body has what we tend to call natural giftings. Now, people that walk with God view them as coming from God. People that don't believe in God tend to view them as just, you know, well, just natural born whatever. Good genes. But even though you have a natural gifting, and I do believe everybody does, there's something you're good at. And if you can't think of anything you're good at, maybe the thing you need to ask God to help you be better at is being able to see what it is that you're good at. There's a profundity I'll let you think on for a while. But everybody has natural giftings. But it's not enough to just lean on those. We should take those and begin to develop them and try to sharpen our skills. And somewhere in that process, what started as natural giftings can also come to a point where there is an anointing of God's Spirit that comes on and raises those skills to another level. raises those abilities to another level. I've had people that have even said sometimes when they've asked them, how do you do this, or how do you, and you can always tell, it's interesting, some people are real honest about it, they say, I'm not sure. Stuff just kind of comes to me. I'm you know, there's musicians that are just anointed. They didn't get there just from the normal processes of practice and learning, but there's an anointing that comes on. Stuff just comes to their minds. And here, my wife's one of those. So learned to play the organ by herself as a young teenager. Smaller than that. Had one of them little Wurlitzer kind of organs in the house. And it was so bad they got her headsets to plug it in so they didn't have to hear it. But she got to praying, and the Spirit of the Lord began to anoint. Kind of shocked everybody when the earphones came off, and all of a sudden, sounds were coming out of there. And even some of our musicians have noticed. They've asked her, how do you hear? She said, I don't know. I don't even know what it is. She said, but I know it. I can hear it. What is it? That's an anointing. It's what started in a natural gift becomes anointed. I want to walk in my natural gifts, but I want more than that. I want God to anoint what it is that I do. I want Him to be pleased with what it is that I do. But one of the keys to anointing is I have to use what it is He's anointed me to do. I got to do something with it. And when I sit back and refuse to qualify myself, it is a form of rebellion. Oh, man. Just derailed this Bible study. But I feel like that's what some of us do. Because we're being lazy, or we just don't want to, you know. But if God has anointed you, it is every joint supplies. One of the keys to serving the Lord is to serve Him with gladness. And that means more than when you come to church. Some of you don't even work it when you come to church. So if you're not doing it here, I know you're not doing it anywhere else. And I'm sure if you're not being happy here, I doubt you're being happy at work on Monday morning. And so we walk into our field grumpy. Bad mood. Sometimes an outright bad spirit. And you know what the reason is? It's because many of us don't see the connection between serving God and serving Him through our work. We don't see it. Yes, they're separate things, but yet they are connected, or they should be. If we're really blessed in it, they will be connected. Because what happens is to us, we tend to enjoy serving God at church. And man, if I could just be in church all the time, if I could just live at the church all the time, then those of us that half do are thinking, oh, if I could just get a day off and not be at the church sometime. Because in our minds sometimes, unless we're doing something that's directly connected with the church, we have this subterranean idea in the back of our mind that this thing is just what I gotta go do till I can get back to being happy about God again, getting back into church. Work's just something I have to do. But one thing is certain, you can survive with that kind of attitude, but you'll never thrive. You cannot be blessed in your field if every morning you go walking into your field with a grumpy attitude. Shikamoshai. Bring up 2 Thessalonians a moment, chapter 3 on screen. For even when we were with you, this we commanded you, that if any would not work, neither should he what? For we hear, there's rumors, that there are some of you that walk among you disorderly. Now, what did he call disorderly? Working not at all, but are busybodies. Now, everybody say now. Them that are such, we command and exhort. Now, by the way, don't confuse when he says work here. Don't confuse that work is not always direct employment. Somebody say, I'm a homemaker. I'm taking care of my kids. I should be paid for this. It is work, but not every work we do is compensated as employment. But if you're going to be halfway decent at it, you better do it under the joy of the Lord. So when he says there are some working not at all or busybodies, I'm not talking about somebody that just doesn't have a secular job. I'm talking about somebody, they're just not being productive at nothing. And because they're not doing anything, they got way too much time on their hands. And somehow Paul had heard the rumors of this from several towns away before they ever invented the internet or the phone or any other kind of communication we have. And so he sends word back by letter, snail mail. Them that are such, we command and exhort by our Lord Jesus Christ that with quietness they work and eat their own bread. Now that's a King James way of saying, shut up and get a job. Get busy doing something with your life. Get busy becoming productive, doing something. You know what's interesting when I read that is the simple acknowledgement that after 2,000 years, human nature hasn't changed. It's consistent in every generation, regardless of technology. 1 Peter 5:8, Paul went on to say, but if any man provide not for his own, and especially those of his own house, he's denied the faith and is worse than an infidel. Drill down on that a little bit. He said it's worse than an unbelieving derelict. You've heard of the term dereliction of duty. Just meaning that it's been left go to a condition of poor or neglect. Now here's the point that I'm trying to, and I only swerve into those verses to remind you that this issue of being of working and being productive and doing something with our life is not, and again, don't confuse it with just secular employment. It's not always the case. But having said that, I'm trying to reiterate the point that we were designed to be productive. And we were even told if we are unproductive, then we should not reap any rewards for our unproductivity. See, the people of God sometimes are very vigilant at church, but too often get less engaged elsewhere in their life, such as school and work. And by the way, when I say work, for young people, I mean school, because that is what your work is right now. That's what you do outside of the home, trying to get ready for the day when you have to carry the full load. So again, don't confuse employment with, I'm using the broad term. When I say work, I'm saying being involved and productive, working on something, trying to do something with your life. Sinners, on the other hand, tend to view career as a main focal point because oftentimes they don't view that from faith. So what tends to happen is it's more of a status thing to them, and sometimes they're more driven to be successful or to show success and to succeed than sometimes the people of God are. Now, there's obviously examples that are opposite of that, but I'm just talking about in a real general tendency. That's why Paul said, if we above all men, we're most miserable if we don't have any hope outside of just this life. But we understand there is more to life than just, you know, work and what we do. And there is an eternity. Can you say amen? But we are people who've been in God's presence, and we have other priorities. And so sometimes we view what we do as, this is just what I got to do until I can get back to church or get back to doing something for God. But it's hard to be blessed with that kind of an attitude or that kind of a viewpoint. Somewhere we'll have to see the connection between serving God in the church and we continue to serve God in our workplace. We serve God through what we do, whether it is here or not here. As a matter of fact, my observation has been is when you show me an individual who's not having a sense of productivity, and I will show you a person that's more than likely wrestling with depression. Because we were made to be productive. And so what happens in the church, if we have a bunch of people that are not being as productive as they could be, and then they get depressed about it, then the pastor has to spend half of our time just trying to dig you out of the mully grubs just so we can get you to neutral so we can have church. And then you can sit in the middle of awesome services, great preaching, anointed Spirit of God, people getting the Holy Ghost and all kinds of stuff, and then fall away because you're convinced that, well, I don't know, it's just the church isn't doing anything for me. No, that's not the problem. The problem is you're not doing anything for the kingdom. It's not the kingdom that's failing you, it's you're failing the kingdom. And that's why you fight depression. That's why you have this sense of failure that sometimes is an exaggerated thing because the enemy tries to do that with all of us. But I'm talking about the issues when sometimes, you know, and you're not always going to avoid depression, by the way. People, I remember reading an article one time about a guy that was convicted of murder. He murdered three people, and he was talking about how he feels depressed about it. And I thought, yeah, hello. You ought to feel depressed about it. Sometimes popping every pill we can find to avoid every little bit of depression that we get is hurting us, I think, more than helping us. Because it kind of numbs even what can be a conviction of the Holy Ghost in some occasions. It's not always, but in some occasions. There's no abundant life, joy. But what if I told you, that God is interested in your day-to-day work and he's just as interested in what you do Monday as he is what you do here on Sunday? As a matter of fact, in some cases, I could make the argument that there are some occasions when God is even more interested in what's happening on Monday than what happened on Sunday. Could you believe that God wants to bless you in your work field and make you a bigger influence than what you are, not only for the sake of lost souls, but to bring provision to yourself, to your family, and then to have extra provision that you can be a blessing to others on top of that, which only leads into the feeling of self-worth. So ask yourself this. How many of you, now 39 of you filled out a paper that I said you want to be involved in outreach. So let me ask you a question. How many of you want to win a soul? Would you raise your hand? Now those of you that don't want to win a soul, we'll have a separate class for you. And we'll see if we can dig you out of the pit because you're in a level I don't know what to do with. But if you really want to win a soul, ask yourself this. What's the one place in general culture where lost people and saved people tend to mix more time than anywhere else? The workplace, the school, whatever your work is. Again, I'm talking generalities. So I work in an office, just me and another person. I know, you're the exception to the rule, all right? But as a general rule, we're out in the culture more during the time of our working careers. Now, you know what that means? That actually means that the workplace is, for some of us, the largest mission field we'll ever be in. You don't have to quit your job to be a missionary. Matthew 9:37 on screen. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is truly plenteous, but the problem is the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his harvest." Another place, he literally said it this way. He said, "The harvest is white, all ready to harvest." What did that mean? If you look at a wheat field, when wheat is ready to be harvested, the top portions of that plant become very, very light. And in some angles of how the sun hits it, it can have a whitish gleam to it. That's what Jesus was referring to when he was talking about Samaria. And he was saying, this place is ready. He said, don't wait and say 4 months and then cometh the harvest. He said, I'm telling you, it's white now. Now, why did he tell them that? It's because they didn't know he had just been to Samaria and met the woman at the well and had engaged with a sinner and had sent her on her way, and she started telling others. And others started getting interested in him. And from one conversation with a sinner, he was having all kinds of conversations. So he said to his disciples, don't wait for this one. Samaria is ready now. Most people don't have to quit their job to become missionaries. But you know where the problem is? Some of us are so backward about living our faith outside of these walls that there's people around us at our job that don't even know we go to church, let alone where we go to church. And we have this spirit that comes on us that just wants to fit in, be one of the guys, so to speak. You got to understand something, church. We're not called to fit in. We are called to rise above. Come out from among them and be ye separate does not mean weird, though some of them may think that it is. What they should find weird is the fact that we're separated out. They should not find us being weird. And when you have no explanation for why you're doing what you're doing, you come across as an idiot and weird. Oh, you must be a member of one of them cults. Oh, no, don't you blame that on here, because one of the main things about a cult is they're very wrapped around a charismatic leader and does anything that they say. And I can't get enough people around here to do what I'm saying to come even near to the definition of a cult. Oh, yes. When we fail to live our faith out around the people of the world that are around us, we fail Christ. And it's a horrible failure of our Christianity. If we had the opportunity to witness to a big crowd, if I'd say to somebody, say, listen, I want you to go into this play. I want you, there's 200 people that are going to be there that want to hear your testimony. Or let's raise the stakes. There's 500 people there. Let's go crusade to make sure everybody's interested. There's 5,000 people there. You would make yourself sick with nervousness. You'd be praying, asking God, help me. I want to please you. I want to do this right. You'd be meticulous in how you dressed. You'd be meticulous in how you acted around people. You'd be on your A game because you are concerned about something more than yourself. You're concerned about being a witness. But the fact of the matter is, most of us will never have those opportunities to be on the stage with hundreds at a time. But yet every day we walk in and out of circumstances where we are on the stage sometimes with dozens at a time. And they don't even know what it is we believe. Because we view work as just some nasty thing that I got to do so I can get back to walking with God. And I want to bring a revelation to the church. When he said the laborers are few, it's because he dispatches us to, what one man said, patches of people. Patches of people. And some people that you work, go to school with, live around, etc., neighborhood, whatever the connection is, they will never have a reason to hear the preaching of the word if somebody hasn't touched them and made them interested in it. And one reason we are less successful at times than what we could be is because, and I'm not saying this is all time, just saying there are some people who are not quite hungry yet and ready yet on individual levels, but in almost every patch of people that we're sent to, there's evangelism opportunities that are white and ready to harvest, but sometimes our living carelessly, kind of, we lose our witness with them. And they write us off as just being, you know, that's, hello? Author Robert Maddox wrote a book I'm kind of enjoying. He said this way, he said, if we had our way as Christians, every day would be Sunday. Don't have to go to work. Unless you happen to work for the church or be involved in some ministry. But that's not work. That's you know. Now, if we were sinners, every sinner, for them, every day would be Saturday night. But most sinners won't go to church or prayer meeting on their own. And true people of God won't go bar hopping. And I got to qualify it. True saints won't go to the stag party or the club or whatever. So where do you mix? Where do you intermingle? Where do you have evangelism opportunities? Most often case, if you would examine, most people will find that their greatest opportunity to touch others is often through their field of labor some sort. The problem is, we have people that want to just teach a Bible study at work all day and talk about it, and you overkill it. Listen, nobody is going to listen to you at work until they have seen you excel in your work. If they're having to cover your slack and your lack and your laziness or whatever, don't think you're going to have a home Bible study with them. Won't happen. Okay? Can I give you an observation of someone that's been around for a little while? Not an old man. I feel like it at times. But I've been around enough. I got almost 30 years of pastoral work, another 4 or 5 years of ministry. That's long enough to have an opinion. And my observation is this. In the house of God, most of the marital issues that I've heard through the years, most of the family problems that I've heard through the years, most of the problems at school or work problems or financial issues or whatever, I'm going to say a pretty bold statement here, but I'm going to say that a high majority of all the troubles that I've ever heard come across my desk, I would say are rooted back in a failure of Christianity, not the failure of the marriage or the job. In other words, the marriage is struggling because Christianity is struggling. People aren't being Christians. Good news is we're over halfway. It boils down to a failure of Christianity. Now, there are some issues that we, you know, there's other issues that are not, but a lot of it is, I've had people say, well, this one did that, and this one said this, and this one did that, and sometimes I'm just sitting there thinking, where did the idea ever get into your head that that's acceptable activity or attitude for a child of God? It's Christianity that's where the struggle is. Because it comes to somebody fix my home, somebody fix this, somebody fix that. Sometimes we do need help, there's no question about it. But I could tell you the help is a whole lot more able to get to us if the first thing we would guard is our own Christian spirit and our own personal righteousness. We spend a lot of wasted counseling time going in circles because we ignore the pulpit. I'm amazed how many times I've said to people in private one-on-one talks stuff that I've spent an entire message teaching and preaching about. And it just occurs to me they didn't listen to a thing that was said. I'd like to be able to say, I want to remind you of this, but sometimes when I go to remind them, I can see the look in their eyes. They don't have a clue what I'm talking about. It's because we're not engrafting the Word. We don't have enough honor and respect for the Word to, even if we have to miss a service, to go. You know, folks, we're making it as easy as we know how. We spent thousands of dollars putting in computers and cameras and NAC apps and everything else because, you know, people have to work. They got this and that and the other, and traveling, sick, and whatever. We're doing everything we can to deliver the Word to you wherever we can, because I'm trying to get the Word out. But some of us are so lazy that we won't take advantage of that. And then we wonder why. Well, I'm going to get on a tangent that I don't have time for. So let's bring up John 17. Jesus said, I have given them thy word, and the world hateth them, because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. When you experience somebody in the world mistreating you or being irritated at you because of your Christianity, that is not necessarily a problem. Sometimes it might mean you're doing something a little bit right. Now, what you got to make sure is they're not being irritated at you for doing silly little stuff that is your fault. But when they hate you because you live different, well, I live different because of the Word. And I'm sorry that my conviction of the Word doesn't make you happy. But it doesn't change the fact that I'm going to live by the Word. But some of us don't like that kind of pressure. And I'm thinking that it might be because we don't have a deep enough conviction in our spirit that God will right the ship at some point. I pray not that thou should take them out of the world, but you should keep them from evil. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. As thou hast sent me into the world, even so send I. I've sent them into the world. There's nobody that's been more successful, obviously, than Jesus himself. But I might want to remind you, he had a little bit of a rough time. And you and I will encounter a little bit of a rough time here and there. But if you trust him, and if you live right, you understand We are in the world, but we're not of the world. We are to be insulated, but not isolated, because if we are isolated, we cannot win the world. We have no evangelism opportunities living in a compound somewhere. I'm beginning to feel and realize that the system of secular employment is actually of God's design. It goes back to the garden. I'm giving you a design. Dress it and keep it. It was the first job description. And then when Adam sinned, the Lord didn't necessarily change the job description. He just pointed out, it's going to be a whole lot harder from here on out. Because your choices have set you under a curse rather than walking in a blessing. You see, the secular employment is how God gives a provision for his people. I believe that one of the reasons, there's a number of them, but one of the reasons that America became so blessed in a financial sense, more so than any nation in the history of the world. And sometimes we Americans, especially some of our younger ones, are so clueless as to what the big picture of world history is. You don't live in a normal circumstance. You live in, even in our rough times, is more blessed than most places around the world. And the reason is because of a form of government and a form of economy that we have. There is nothing that flows any greater over time than a fairly balanced, regulated capitalism that is born in the freedom of individuals to choose. You show me economies like that in the world, and they are always the economies that are on top consistently. And socialism contradicts so many biblical principles, it's never blessed. I remember we're just a couple of years ago in the news, everybody was talking about Venezuela. We need to be like them. We need to be like them. And then now in the last year, when it's all falling apart and going crazy and every, you know, I don't know what happened to all the people that were screaming, we need to be like this. I kept saying, somebody needs to wake up and smell the coffee and realize that's the last thing we need, is to be like that. What we need to be is, we need to get back to the principles of what made us great to begin with. And one of those principles is the principle of rewarding hard work. But Pastor, don't you remember in the book of Acts when there was a crisis and they sold all they had and distributed among each other? Yes, that did happen. One time. In response to a political crisis. And I like to think that we would be able to do the same in certain levels of Christ. But that was never the design that he put the New Testament church in. Oh, Pastor, don't you remember in the Old Testament when Israel was in the wilderness, wandering in the wilderness, and God fed them every day with manna and water, even quail? Yeah, key word is wandering. When they were wandering in the wilderness, God provided them water out of a rock, manna that fell out of the sky. And when they got so fed up with that, he gave them a little bit of quail. But I got to tell you something. As cool as that is, it's not cool after 40 years. And so the question is why didn't God up the menu a little bit? God refused to do it. Except for a little bit of mercy they showed him with the quail. It's because God understood something. He did not want Israel to get into a welfare entitlement mentality. The reason that he didn't want that is because that mentality tends to entrap people in poverty. Whenever you are sustaining yourself from something other than some form of something that you're doing to feel productive and to feel like you're accomplishing something. It is directly related to the psychology of a man or a woman. We were not designed to sit and do nothing. That brings depression. Marvin Olansky wrote an incredible book one time called The Tragedy of American Compassion. It's worth reading because it's quite eye-opening about the results of our great society, the fact that we have given billions of dollars away to people to meet needs in the name of compassion. And yet the poverty level in our nation today is just as high as it was in the 1960s when it started. We've made no impact on the big picture. And then, in a lot of ways, we've made a lot of greater problems bigger because we kept rewarding poor decisions. Keep having babies out of wedlock. Well, okay, we'll up your Social Security. We'll up the welfare. We'll up the food program. We'll up the... You can only do that which gets rewarded is what gets done. And so if you keep making life easy for somebody that keeps making poor decisions, then the odds are that they will continue to make poor decisions because they haven't run yet into the principle that the Apostle Paul laid out that said, if a man won't work, then don't let him eat. You want to know how to fix behavior relatively quickly? You know, in our modern times, we live in sealed houses. When you see that term in the scripture, but understand, our sealed houses are a whole lot better than what they had. We live in sealed houses. We have heating and air conditioning systems. When they break down, we can call a repairman. We have factories that produce cars, appliances, tools to fix them, roads to drive on. We have a standard of living that is higher than any other time in the history of humanity. And the reason, in part, is because God allowed our work to become blessed. I said it earlier, but people have natural giftedness. Rush Limbaugh became the number one talk radio host, literally, in the history of America. More people listen to him on a weekly basis, over 20 million or so his audience. Incredible success story. But he said something way back in the beginning that got so much heat. He had a little ditty that would come on when he's advertising a show. Rush Limbaugh, talent on loan from God. Oh, people got so angry. They got upset. They got off. I remember hearing people call in, and I was laughing because I knew he's just yanking their chain is all he's doing. They're not smart enough to realize what he's doing. But the thing is, he was right. We all have talent that is only on loan from God. You ever notice how some people, they're just mechanically gifted? There's some people, they don't know what to do with a wrench. What's that? There's other people that see a wrench and they see things behind it starting to happen because of you. What is that? It's a giftedness. So my dad was a good mechanic. Yeah, there's some things that kind of flow from generation to generation, but somebody needs to wake up and understand where it all started, and that was it was talent on loan from and those talents need to be honed, and they need to be cultivated, and they need to be upgraded and used. I believe God gives every one of us natural giftings and abilities. Number one, he gives it to us so that we could bless his house and his kingdom. Number two, I believe he also gives it to us so that we can be a blessing to ourselves and our own family. In other words, have something that I can make a living at. That's why he said in Galatians 6 and 9, let us not be weary in well-doing. In due season we shall reap if we faint not. Then he said, as we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men. Everybody say all men. But especially unto them who are of the household of faith. Again, I take you back to the principles. There are certain things you can do that will bring the blessings of God. There are certain things you can do that will not bring the blessing of God. And not treating one another correctly in the body concerning business issues is a surefire way to have the blessing of God continually restricted to your household. More so than anybody else. Twelve minutes, folks. It'll be all right. The workplace is supposed to be a source of our blessing, but it's also a place of stress sometimes. It can be a stress, or it can be a place of difficulty. We have work environments that sometimes can be difficult, stress-filled, maybe unfair working conditions. Sometimes a mean boss, that's the bunch that work for me, have a problem with. So you can't let your light shine in a bright place. So sometimes God allows us to walk into dark places so that our light really shines. Think about it from a historical standpoint. The 21st century church has more interaction with a lost world than probably any other generation before us. Even American history, for a great part of our national history, we were rural people. Everybody grew up on farms. Sometimes the neighbor's house was 2 miles away. As a matter of fact, up until the latter part of the central to latter part of the 20th century, even in America, 80% of our population lived in rural places. But that's not true today. In the 21st century, now today, 80% of our population is in metro urban areas. You understand, in the last 100 years, there's been a total switch. And not just here. That's happened in other developed countries. So we've become an urban nation. In my opinion, I think the reason that God has orchestrated this and allowed it to come to pass is it's setting the stage for end time revival. And we've got to think sometimes. Look, I'll be honest with you. I prefer a little more country living if you're going to give me the simple choice of just doing what I want to do. However, I also recognize I'm in the people business. And so therefore I need to be where people are. Not where the deer and the buffalo roam. It's so quiet, I hear the baptistry tank. John 4. Jesus said unto them, my meat's to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. Don't say they're yet 4 months, then cometh the harvest. I was quoting this earlier. He said, lift up yourselves, look on the fields, they're white already to harvest. And he that reapeth receiveth wages and gathereth fruit into life eternal. And both he that soweth and he that reapeth may rejoice together. And herein is that saying true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap that whereon you bestowed no labor. Other men labored and you entered into their labors. And many of the Samaritans of that city believed on him for the saying of the woman which testified, hey, she said, he told me everything that I ever did. The harvest is white. By the way, little side note for those of you that want to venture into the gifts of the Spirit and want to hunger after it. I'm not poo-pooing the idea. We're told to earnestly seek for those best gifts. But you need to understand something about those gifts. God is not gifting you so that you can tweak and correct the body every day. We're to edify the body. My job description for the pulpit is reprove, rebuke, and exhort. That's not the job description of the general saints in the body of Christ. That job description is reconcile, lift up, edify. Little free note. And in this case, he used his spiritual sensitivity to start a revival and to win the lost. Woman at the well. He gets to talking to her about her marriage. She said, "I'm not married." Jesus, I'm sure, chuckled and smiled at her when he said it. You can say a lot of stuff when you're smiling. Yeah, I know, you're right. You've said it right. You're not married. But you've been married a few times, and the one you're living with now, you're shacked up with him. He did not say it in a rebuking manner because she didn't take it in a rebuking manner. She was fascinated by somebody that could read her mail. And it opened up a conversation. And he used the gifts of the Spirit to draw and begin revival. Not metal. Do you know that statistically, the average person, they say, spends 63% of their waking hours at work or work-related activities? Now think about this. How many times have we as the people of God blamed the sinners for the lousy atmosphere at work? But hear this. What if we had the ability and the opportunity to change that atmosphere? Well, there's not enough of me. It's amazing what God can do with one person that'll just do right and represent him right. You see, most people, most work problems are not work problems. Mostly they're people problems. You have people, "I hate being a mechanic." No, you don't. Ask yourself, is it really the cars you don't like working on, or is it the customers you hate dealing with? What is it that you do? Is it actually the work that you hate, or is it the people that are around that drain you? I would bet most of the time we would say it's a people problem. It's usually not our craft that we dislike so much, but it's the interaction of people and policy. And there's no question, people will wear you out. But Jesus did not allow that to be an excuse to alleviate us from our responsibility of interacting with the lost. As a matter of fact, he did it. Now, he never partook of their sin. That's where some of you dropped the ball. "Well, I'm just trying to be friends." You cannot win someone being like them. How do you pull someone out of the mud pit when you're in it up to your own waist yourself? Oh, and by the way, if somebody really is wanting out of their pit, they're not going to look to somebody that's in it with them. They're going to look for somebody that has some moral higher ground to stand on. That's why you'll have people that you know, they'll chuckle, they'll make fun of you, they'll tease you about this, that, and the other, and you let a crisis come. If you've lived right before them, they'll come to you asking you to pray about this. "Can you help me with this? Can you open up a door?" But they won't give you a dime's worth of time until they have tested out and felt out how you are. You real or not? Or are you just one of them fakers? Stop being less than what you should be. Stop living less than you should be. Stop dressing less than you should dress. Stop going where you shouldn't go. You're destroying your witnesses. Oh, as long as nobody at the church knows. That always comes out. You know why? Because God knows what we're doing. And here's the interesting thing. You can stumble around me, and I might be a little disappointed and try to help you out, but I'm not going to stumble because you've stumbled. So the actual reality is there is probably a little less damage when you fall a little short here than there is if you fall a little short in a circumstance where you're the only apostolic voice in the building. And they will stumble because you stumbled. You'll never win the loss by not having any life boundaries. That's why it concerns me when I hear saints every once in a while say, well, my best friends are in the world. I don't see how that's actually biblically possible. That doesn't mean that we can't have people that are friends. Sometimes we have kids we grow up with, that kind of thing. But by definition, the more you do this thing called Christianity correctly, the Bible says, can two walk together unless they be agreed? At some point, if you're healthily walking with God, there is going to come lines that have to be drawn between what you will and will not do, what you can and cannot do, what you will tolerate and not tolerate. And it brings division, not because you're trying to create one, but just because it's your honor of the word. At some point, our walk with God brings us to a place where we have to draw some lines. And when we do, sometimes we get upset and feel like this ain't working. Just go back to the word. Read the word. What's the word tell you to do? Trust the word. And if you will trust the word, God will bring you out on the other side of that thing. And you'll have more respect than you ever had before. I have lived this so many times. I'm convinced of it. But we're out of time tonight. So next Wednesday night we'll pick up with part 3. Stand with me tonight. How many of you still want to be blessed in your field? Hallelujah. Lift up your voice and let's praise God right now. Hallelujah. Jesus, we love you. Lord, I loose this teaching into the body of Christ tonight. I loose this teaching to us in Jesus' name. God, help us to become more productive in the kingdom. Help us to serve you in our work. Help us to walk blessed and let people see the anointing of heaven upon our life, even when they don't understand it. Help us, God, to posture ourselves for increase, to fulfill the prophecy that is upon us for this year. In the name of Jesus. Now give the Lord a hand clap offering of praise and give him a shout of victory. Across this. Praise. Shake hands, greet one another in the name of the Lord. We'll see you all Sunday morning. Have a great week in the name of the Lord.